Many people question why we learn history. Some say that we shouldn't learn history, that history is just useless information that we can't use on a day-to-day basis. And others say that history is of the utmost importance. A great man once said, "We spend a great deal of time studying history, which, let's face it, is mostly the history of stupidity." That man was Stephen Hawking. His statement leads to the idea that we learn history because of our mistakes, not just to acknowledge them, but to evolve from them. History is full of humans' mistakes, mistakes that we strive not to repeat. This means for every story of tragedy, there are lessons to teach next generations as how not to repeat our mistakes. From wars to genocide, each has plenty to teach us. But what does the Salem witch trials have to teach us? What were they and what happened? The period known as the Salem witch trials took place in Salem Village, Massachusetts, 1692. Salem Village was exhibiting a period of anxiety, paranoia, and fear because of food shortages, nearby natives, and disease. They believed that supernatural forces were allied with the devil to take away everything they had. What sparked the witch trials was a group of young women that had experienced a noticeable change in behavior. They were diagnosed by doctors as bewitched. They were encouraged to accuse their neighbors of bewitching them, and because of the circumstances at the time, the accusations were accepted and trials were held to appoint the accused. These trials were held against elder women mostly because women were seen as sinful and morally weak compared to that of men. This can be traced back to the story of Adam and Eve, where Eve was easily seduced by the devil to eat the apples from the tree of knowledge, and she then went on to convince Adam to do it as well. The women who were the first accusers of the witch trials are known as the Afflicted Girls, and they include Betty Paris, Elizabeth Booth, Elizabeth Hubbard, Mercy Lewis, Ann Putnam Jr., Susanna Sheldon, Abigail Williams, Mary Walcott, and Mary Warren. These women began to experience episodes of fear, hysteria, and contorting pain. All of the Afflicted Girls began to experience these symptoms around the same time. A doctor by the name Dr. William Griggs was called in to examine the women to see what the issue was. He was the doctor that made the original diagnosis that the women were bewitched. Eventually, the women were encouraged by parents to give their accusations of the women who had bewitched them. The accused women were Sarah Good, Sarah Osborne, and a slave named Tituba. It is said that on March 1st, 1692, Tituba had confessed that she and the other accused women were all witches who worked under Satan, and that there were more witches in Salem. This confession dropped Salem into an even larger state of hysteria. There were massive witch hunts, which included the trials of four women after the originally accused. Though the Afflicted Girls were the main accusers during the trials, it is believed that parents Samuel Paris and Thomas Putnam had encouraged the women's accusations. As of April, there were 21 more people that were accused of witchcraft, both men and women. The governor, William Phipps, had established a new court to deal with such cases concerning witchcraft and the supernatural. The known judges of this court were John Proctor, Jonathan Corwin, Bartholomew Gedney, John Richards, William Stoughton, Samuel Sewall, Nathaniel Staltonstall, Peter Sargent, and Waitstill Winthrop. By the end of the trials, over 200 people were accused, 150 were arrested, but only 20 had actually been killed by execution, and 4 had died in prisons awaiting their trial. Currently listed are the names of the people who were executed via hanging in the witch trials. Listed right here are the people who died in prison while awaiting their trial. Giles Corey was also killed, but he was tortured to death, and in order to get a confession out of Corey, the judge stacked rocks on his stomach until he died. There are many locations that are relevant to the history of Salem, including the Witch House, which was Judge Jonathan Corwin's house and is also the last standing structure that has a direct connection to the trials. There was also the path from jail to execution. This is where George Corwin would drive the accused to their execution, and here he would also sign their death warrant. There is also the Salem Witch Trials Memorial, which was built on the 300th anniversary of the witch trials by Holocaust survivor Nobel Laureate. There is also the Salem Museum. This is the site of Reverend Higginson's church. Importantly, there was the Salem Jail. This is where the accused were held until Child and four innocents had fell victim in this jail. There is the Salem Courthouse. This is the courthouse where people were tried and convicted by judges. And lastly, there is Proctor's Ledge. This is the site where people were executed by hanging, named after Judge John Proctor. It has been nearly 330 years since the Salem Witch Trials had begun, and this period has remained relevant to modern times. There are around 70 locations that are all dedicated to that of the Salem Witch Trials. There have also been countless books spawned from the Salem Witch Trials, including that of the Salem Witch Trials, A Day-by-Day Chronicle of a Community Under Siege by Marilyn K. Roach, and Salem Possessed, The Social Origins of Witchcraft by Paul Boyer and Stephen Niesenbaum. There have also been many representations of the trials by television shows, such as DC's Legends of Tomorrow, where the characters travel back in time and save Sarah Good, who was one of the first victims of the trials. Also a very popular representation of the trial is the game Town of Salem, where you either play as an innocent town member or a force of evil acting against the town. Some names in the game are based off of real people, like that of John Proctor and Giles Corey. Earlier in the video, I had stated that every tragic story from history has a lesson to teach future generations. What did the witch trials teach us? The witch trials were terrible. 24 people were killed and over 200 more had to fear for their lives as the accused. People of the trials had acted out of hysteria and paranoia. They couldn't explain what was happening to them, so they quickly turned on each other to blame. This taught us that when people are lacking knowledge of certain situations, they always look around themselves for someone else to blame. They always search for a scapegoat. And most of the time, those scapegoats are our neighbors or our friends. So what exactly is the triumph of the witch trials? And the answer to that is that they teach us a lot of lessons about human psychology that can help us further understand the mind. And also, the witch trials show that we shouldn't let our fears trick us into turning on our own people or loved ones. There are many times where we use scapegoats and it caused many to lose their lives, like in the witch trials, or World War I where Germany took the blame, or World War II when the Jews were punished for their beliefs, or the 1900s Comic Censorship Act where comics were blamed for the youth's problems. The witch trials have showed us a lesson of betrayal and death that, if told correctly, can prevent the witch trials from being repeated ever. And if it weren't for the witch trials in the first place, today might be very different.